Good morning and welcome. I'm the Reverend Graham Brownmiller, lead minister here at Jubilee United Church. Today I'm leading worship with assistance from Anne and Barb. Whoever you are, wherever you are, thank you for joining us. We're grateful that you're with us. For generations, Indigenous peoples have walked on this land. Their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives and their spirituality. As an act of faith and reconciliation, we acknowledge that we gather on the shared, ancestral, and unceded lands of the Minam and Squamish speaking peoples. We equally respect each of the nations who share territory here. We want to affirm you in your presence with us, truly hoping that you find a place for yourself here. It's what we strive for, even when we miss the mark. No matter how little or great you feel your faith is, no matter if it's your first time coming to this or any church, you were raised here, or it's the first time coming in a while, no matter what it is that you might think keeps you from connecting to the source of all being, we hope that you feel included in what we do here today. We recognize that it is our differences that bring us together. Our stage of life, personality, gender identity and expression, sexual orientation, language, skin color, culture, race, marital or economic status, ability, and whether or not you consider yourself a Christian. God affirms all of us in this diverse family, and we are welcome here. We light candles regularly. We light this candle as a reminder of God's love and presence in our lives. It's a symbol of light that can never be put out, that can never be overcome by the shadows. It is a reminder of Christ. Let there be light. We come, careful as we live as wise ones, making the most of the time. We come, understanding the will of God, filled with the Spirit, singing and praying, making melody to God in our hearts, giving thanks to God at all times and for everything. We come to worship. Let us pray. We are complex beings, O God, who bring our whole selves to this time of worship, never really sure of what we're leaving behind, and never really sure what we might find inside ourselves as we offer all that we are. We put aside the things that are weighing on us, knowing that we will need to pick them up again, but that while we are here, in this time, it is a moment to open our hearts to you. We come to you, Creator, knowing that we strive to be who you call us to be each and every day, working to find that balance, the sweet spot. We gather in the many names of love. Amen. Children, youth, young at heart, all of us, today we hear a little bit about wisdom in a variety of ways. Wisdom in the Bible is spoken of as Sophia. It's spoken of through the Proverbs, ancient words. That's what we might think about as wisdom nowadays, or learning at the knees of elders, wisdom that comes from the voice of children. There's an old saying that knowledge is knowing that tomato is a fruit. Wisdom is knowing not to put it in a fruit salad. We spend time thinking about what's wise, thinking about how it is that we bring ourselves all of the aspects of who we are, knowing, too, that sometimes we don't put our best foot forward. It's like putting tomato in a fruit salad. It doesn't quite work. And so we spend time hearing our stories, learning and listening and loving together, knowing that God is in the midst of our relationships and our time together. We look forward to a time when we're back together.
Reading from the first book of Kings. Then David slept with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. The time that David reigned over Israel was 40 years. He reigned for 7 years in Hebron and 33 years in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom was firmly established. Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of his father David. Only he sacrificed and offered incense at the high places. The king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the principal high place. Solomon used to offer 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night, and God said, "Ask what I should give you." And Solomon said, "You have shown great and steadfast love to your servant, my father David, because he walked before you in faithfulness, in righteousness, and in uprightness of heart towards you. And you have kept for him this great and steadfast love, and have given him a son to sit on his throne today. And now, O Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David. Although I am only a little child, I do not know how to go out or come in. And your servant is in the midst of the people whom you have chosen, a great people, so numerous they cannot be numbered or counted. Give your servant, therefore, an understanding mind to govern your people, able to discern between good and evil. For who can govern this your great people?" It pleased the Lord that Solomon had asked this. God said to him, "Because you have asked this and have not asked for yourself long life or riches or for the life of your enemies, but have asked for yourself understanding to discern what is right, I now do according to your word. Indeed, I give you a wise and discerning mind. No one like you has been before you, and no one like you shall arise after you. I give you also what you have not asked, both riches and honor all your life. No other king shall compare with you. If you will walk in my ways, keeping my statutes and my commandments, as your father David walked, then I will lengthen your life." And a reading from the letter to the Ephesians. "Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time, because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand the will of God. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to God in your hearts, giving thanks to God at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." And a reading from the Gospel according to John. "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The temple authorities then disputed among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living God sent me, and I live because of God, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever." Hear what the Spirit is saying through these ancient words of Scripture. Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be graced by your wisdom and your love. Amen. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. Okay, except who really wants to live forever? What would we even do? We have trouble abiding slow traffic or, God forbid, a long worship service. Do you really want to live forever? Or do you want to matter forever? When I preach funerals, I often say that a person is never truly dead until we stop telling their story or remembering them. It's one of the things that we do all the time here at church. We continue to tell the story of Jesus and the ancestors in faith because it matters. Jesus matters. What we do together, it matters. The story of our lives matters. We hear that, too, in the story from Kings today, in the prayer for Solomon's desire for wisdom. The rest of the first and second books of Kings are the story of the decline and fall of Israel and Solomon's part in that. But today, we see a different side of Solomon, one that's marked by humility and honesty. That might be the King Solomon that you remember from years past, the wise and humble king whom God blessed and made the richest man in the world. As his father David dies, Solomon genuinely submits himself before God at the beginning of his kingship. He's the same one who will ruthlessly seize power later in the story. Do we dismiss this prayer as an attempt to manipulate God? Or do we recognize that he is a real man, a real king who both sincerely loves God and wants to do God's will, as well as having no qualms about ruthlessly using power? If we can't recognize that with Solomon, then how do we recognize it within ourselves and those that we gather in community with? How do we recognize that we are all complex beings that have multiple modes within our lives and that we sometimes act differently with different people or react differently when life is hard or that we don't know what's going on in someone's life? I want to tell you a story that I once heard about a minister. It would have been in the 60s or 70s, so in the high days of church. A young woman went to an elder in the church to say that though she liked the church and the community, the minister was unfriendly. Now, this elder knew the minister and thought he was an especially warm person, so they asked a few questions. Turns out the young woman had stopped by the church to get something. At the same time, the pastor came out of his office, smiled, and asked, "How are you?" The young woman answered, "Fine," but she said he was so preoccupied he didn't really see me. The elder went to the minister, who was shocked by the young woman's reaction, and so told the elder what had happened. On that day, before 6 a.m., he had received a call from the emergency ward at the hospital. There had been an accident, and a young woman had been killed. The young man who was driving was a member of the church and in critical condition, so the pastor went to the hospital immediately. When he returned to his office, his secretary was waiting nervously, wondering if he would get back to the funeral home on time for another memorial service. Back to the office without breakfast or lunch, and there on the desk was a message marked urgent. The chair of finance wanted to know which bills to pay and leave unpaid this month. A young couple was waiting, watching the clock. They were on their lunch hour and were there for premarital counseling. Another call from the wife of a sick man, not in critical condition, but she was irate that the pastor had not yet called on her husband. Books and notes scattered all around, and as he looked at the disarray, he wondered in fatigue and discouragement when he would be able to get back to his sermon preparation. Then the phone rang. It was the hospital again. The young man was responding, but was still critical and wanted to see his pastor. It might be the last chance that they had to speak together. So he dashed out of his office to get to the hospital. It was at that moment that the young woman walked down the hall of the church. The fact that he was collected enough to smile and say anything to her at all was a miracle. Of course, he was preoccupied. Now, in addition to his guilt about not getting everything done, he had another problem. What could he do to win her confidence again? How do we recognize the humanness within each of us and allow grace to flow between us and our relationships? The Gospel of John has a recurring motif of narrow-minded understanding, and accordingly, it should function for us as an independent cautionary signal. Don't take things too literally. In John's Gospel, this means opening ourselves to higher or deeper or more poetic forms of understanding, modes of thought more fitting for what Jesus himself calls heavenly things. Heavenly things, as opposed to worldly things. We are encouraged so often to devour what the world tells us when we need to consume. The latest fashions, the largest entertainment package, as much food as we want whenever we want it, bigger and better houses, anything to boost our perceived status. But those things don't necessarily nourish our bodies and our souls. Because this is the third week hearing about the bread of life, we know by now that it's not literal bread, but it is Jesus. And Jesus nourishes. It's not about life everlasting, but an intimate mutual indwelling with God that can begin here and now, well before death. It's not longer life, but life with and in God. Eternal life is a matter of quality, not of quantity. The quality of our lives is made better by what we are nourished by. Taking in the bread of life, we live at the heart of being. The way to live forever is to love the world so much that you become it. If we consume all we can of Jesus, then we begin to nourish the world. But consuming Jesus doesn't just happen here at church. Living, breathing, and abiding in Christ's body each hour of every day is our countercultural calling as Christians, to show Christ to the world through our words and actions every day of our lives, both individually and as a worshiping community. Instead of devouring what the world tells us, we need to nourish our bodies and souls with Jesus, intimately acquainted with his words, his actions, his promises, and his love. We feast on Christ in worship, but we must make our very lives a banquet of hope, grace, and love. We must live with a radical gratitude and a holy hunger, always willing to pull up more chairs to the table. For generations, there have been ways that Christians have made others feel worse about themselves instead of better. There is an appalling history of Christian anti-Judaism since John's day, and we really are obligated to continuously remember and emphasize and maintain a sharp focus on the Jewish foundations and substance of the Gospels, the emphasis on the Passover, the reliance on stories and motifs from human scripture, the fact that the disciples called Jesus rabbi, and so on. Some take comments like today's and John to perpetrate that anti-Judaism. The author of the Gospel of John used the shorthand, the Jews, to mean those in the Jewish community who didn't embrace the Jesus movement, as opposed to those in the Jewish community who did. Thus, John's shorthand should never be understood as referring to the Jewish people as a whole, nor should it ever be used to denigrate those of the Jewish faith. Even if we're not inviting others to the banquet, as in communion around this table, we still want to offer radical gratitude and hospitality. We still have to be wise about our relationships. Paul writes to those in Ephesus and reminds them that the idea of being wise is important, that worship is a wise and important thing that we do. But we have learned, too, that worship is not just about this time that we set apart on Sunday, but it is what we do when we live the Jesus story. When we feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the sick, take time to sit with a friend, admire the beauty of nature, all of those things are ways that we worship. When we respond with curiosity rather than judgment, when we acknowledge that we don't know what's going on with others, when we engage in deep, abiding relationship, we're worshiping. When we recognize that each of us, like Solomon, are complex beings who truly want to live the best lives that God has called us to, we worship. And we recognize that when we gather in person, online, over time and space, and continue to tell the story of the one whose life mattered and matters, we are blessed beyond measure. This is our story. This is our call to faith. This is our community. May it be so in your life and in mine. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Here we are again, O God, sharing our praise, giving our thanks, counting on your constant grace. Keep us ever grateful for and ever generous with the life and abundance we enjoy. Keep us ever mindful of and ever careful with this amazing world, all those who love and guide us, this Jubilee community that embraces us. We have the audacity to believe in you. We ask for the audacity to believe that we, through your Spirit, can live the life you dream for us. Here we are again, O God, sharing our concerns, seeking your help, counting on your wisdom and love, asking for you to answer our prayers. For the lost and forgotten, may they be found and remembered. For the victims of fires, violence, marginalization, war, racism, abuse, and neglect, may they find peace, safety, justice, and love. For those who oppress and tear down, may they experience such grace that they will in turn liberate and build up. For the rich and the poor, may you show them to each other's ends and bring them to the middle, that they will take better care of each other. For this polluted and broken world, may its beauty be restored and its wounds healed. And may we work together to change the climate, stop the fires and floods, and repair the damage we have done. For politicians and leaders, may they be inspired and then guided by a passion for justice, and may they not be swayed by the seductions of power and wealth. For our children, may they learn from our mistakes, right our wrongs, and lead this world towards your future. For our church, may we live the faith, know the love, and voice the hope that you promise and provide. Give us, we pray, the vision to see that none are too low to serve, too lost to love, or too high to hear the cries of your world. We have the audacity to believe in you. We ask for the audacity to believe that we, through your Spirit, can answer some of those cries. And here we are again, O God, asking you to hear us as we pray silently for all those in our church, family, and in our hearts, the lonely, the depressed, the grieving, the ill, the scared, the angry. We remember especially Susie Raphael recovering from surgery and Ralph Cochran recovering from a fall. We also give thanks for and pray for the well-being of exhausted firefighters and generous volunteers, and pray for those displaced and devastated by the fires raging in BC. Bless these all with the strength of your love, and bless us with the strength to reflect it. And lastly, we look into our own hearts and souls, and we pray for ourselves. We pray for the things we have left undone, our broken relationships, any hurt we may have caused your world or your people, our own poor health. Forgive us. Call us again to lives of love, caring, and generosity. We lift our prayers to you through Jesus Christ, who taught us the greatest prayer we sing together now.
Done on earth as in heaven.
will be fellowship time following worship today in breakout rooms. Please plan to join us for those. Our hope is that on September 12th, we will rejoin in person for worship here in the sanctuary. That time was chosen so that we have a chance for folks to get their second vaccines and for us to watch what's happening with numbers throughout the summer. And so we will let you know closer to the date if anything changes. But as of right now, our hope is September 12th. Dave Ellis is working on our fellowship coffee schedule, and Dorothy Jeffrey is working on the congregational worship leadership schedule. If you're on a team and haven't heard about it yet, or you have volunteered before but haven't heard anything about a schedule, or you haven't done either of those things before and would like to be part of either of those, please be in touch with Dave around coffee fellowship after church, or with Dorothy for scripture readings, prayer offerers, people who serve communion, people who greet at the door. There's a bunch of things on that list. It has been quite warm, and so we don't want you to be suffering. If you want a place to come and be a bit cooler, it's not super cold, but a bit cooler, you can always come and hang out in the sanctuary. Tuesday to Friday, there's someone here in the church before 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, so come on by and we'll show you how to get out because the door will be maglocked, but it just is a place for you to come if you really want or need a place to be. The thrift shop is open, and hop in as usual. We are accepting donations. We've had a lot, but we're always looking for more. So thanks for continuing to support that ministry. This week we have two birthdays to celebrate, and we'll continue to celebrate birthdays and anniversaries when we return to in-person worship too. We celebrate the birthdays of Kimberly and Carol. Happy birthday to both of you. And then a number of anniversaries. The summer is a busy time for anniversaries. Mark and Tammy celebrate, John and Nancy, Janet and John, Lemuel and Lilia, Deborah and Paul. May you celebrate well and continue to remember that you are surrounded by those who celebrate with you in your community. Friends, for whatever you're able to offer in your time, your prayer, your talent, your financial offering, we're grateful. If you're able and wish to contribute to the financial life of Jubilee United Church, there are a variety of ways. You can drop off or mail in a check. You can join PAR, you can send an e-transfer to the office email address. Someone will come by and pick it up if that makes it easier for you. Those of you who regularly worship other places, we know that they need your support, so please continue to support them and know that we are grateful to offer you this gift. For all that you're able to offer, thank you for your generosity. Let's pray. May these gifts be used as a benefit to the world that you love, and so we love. Help us voice to a world, a word of hope to those who need it. And may we help those who need to know love find it in our common life. Bless the gifts we offer, bless us, and bless those who do not yet know that they were received from all of them. Amen. May we feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit the sick, and in all of that, know that God is present. We go with God who has created and is creating, with Jesus, the Word made flesh, and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.